Hey guys, Aslan Running Guy here, welcome back. Today I'll be talking about Comrades, the ultra marathon held over there in South Africa. So I'm just gonna be basically doing this video because when I found I was actually doing research on the race, I wanted to find out a few little details and some of it I couldn't actually find on YouTube. So I'm just gonna sort of run over those for viewers who may be considering doing it in the future. I'd certainly highly recommend. It has a huge reputation for its atmosphere, which other races have had that I've done. I thought, yeah, it's pretty good. But this is absolutely mind-blowing. The Africans certainly know how to celebrate. It is really one epic event and something you should seriously consider doing. So this year, you held on 9th of June from Durban, which is at sea level, up to Pietermaritzburg. So that's the two cities that it runs in between every year. This year was 87 kilometers. So it was the up year, running from Durban at sea level, like I said, up to Pietermaritzburg, that I think sits at about 620 metres above sea level. So it's called up because you're climbing up to Pietermaritzburg. And then the following year, generally, which I'll explain in a second, they change direction and you run from Pietermaritzburg down to Durban, so it's the down year. So it normally alternates up, down, up, down. This year was the 94th running of the event, so it's been obviously running for a long time. It's the biggest participated ultramarathon in the world and the longest running ultramarathon in the world. It's 94th year and it's on the road. So this year was an up year. The reason I said the next 2 years is actually going to be a down year, two consecutive years running down. I think it's got something to do with an anniversary. But you can probably look further into that on the internet why they're running two consecutive down years, but they are running two consecutive down years. So if you want to run up, you're going to have to wait till 2022. It's a completely different race, up and down. Obviously distance is the same running between the two cities, but it's a completely different race the way you actually have to go about it, and obviously the demands within the body. So I'll sort of go through how it all sort of unfolded. So basically, I flew Canberra, Sydney, Sydney, Joburg, Durban. So international flights, you're gonna have to go into Joburg and down to Durban. So from Sydney, it was a 14-hour flight. I flew over with Qantas. It was, point of interest was ran into a couple of people from Perth, and they actually went to the effort to fly from Perth over to Sydney, 4 hours, whatever it might have been, to get on a Qantas flight to fly back over the west side of Australia over to South America, just so they could get on that Qantas flight, due to the South African Airlines, I don't think had a great reputation. So yeah, it was interesting to see that they got all that effort, adding all that extra time, which was already a long traveling time, basically a day by time, you add in all the transfers in between the airports. So yeah, interesting point. So yeah, so Sydney, Joburg, and then from Joburg, it's about 50 minutes to Durban. 14 hours from Sydney and Joburg. So that's sort of what you're looking at. It's about 8 hour time difference. So yeah, you're gonna have to deal with the jet lag when you get there. So I would recommend getting there 4 or 5 days, whatever it might be, before the race, held on the Sunday in June, or maybe into May, but basically June for the next few years, just to get on top of that. So look, it's 86.93 k's this year, 87 k's, generally it varies here and there, but generally around 87 to 90 k's. It's been under 90 k's for a few years now. So it's pretty solid on the road. It's gonna knock your legs around, so seriously, you have to do some decent training there to deal with that. I stayed in a hotel, pretty much a 70 meter walk from the start line in Durban. It's called the Royal Hotel, as in the Royal Family, the Royal Hotel, which is fine. It's an old hotel that's sort of back in the 19th century. So it's been around for a while, but it's had a few upgrades, but it's fine. So, you know, something I'd recommend, just because, you know, basically wake up, walk across the street, you know, at the start line, which is really, really great on race morning when you've got anxiety and all those stresses and nerves. It's good to be so close to the start line. Now the way it works is there's an expo on that opens up on the Thursday of race week. You pretty much head in there with some ID, driver's license, passport, whatever it might be, pick up your little goodies bag, and in there you'll find all the normal marketing, advertising stuff. But you also get, if you're an international runner, you get a little bit of a wristband that you put around your wrist that you have on during the race, because the way that works is at the end of it, the international runners can actually get into a tent where you pick up some tucker and have a good feed. And you also pick up your, they call it a tote bag. So it's like a bag that you leave at the finish line with any gear that you actually may want. And you won't actually be able to pick up that bag at the finish line unless you've actually got that international wristband on. You'll also pick up your bibs, obviously. Comrades actually has a front and a rear bib, so you got to put two bibs on. And on that bib, if you're an international runner, it'll be like a blue-coloured background bib. And it'll also show you what wave you start in, so like wave 8, or I think it's wave F or G that it goes down to. And that basically goes on your qualifying time, so like sub 3 marathon run, you'll get into group A, and so on and so on. I can't remember exactly how it all works, but maybe 3:20, sub 3:30 gets you in group B, whatever it might be, but it's all on the comrades.com website. So you start in waves, the race starts at 5:30 a.m. So the gun goes off. If you know anything about Comrades, or even if you don't, you can jump on and have a look. They play some music, you know, Chariots of Fire, and they play this South African song. I can't remember the name of it. I probably should have tried to remember it, but it's a very emotional, moving song, and all the South Africans are singing it. And then the famous crow call, and the cannon goes off, and the race starts at 5:30. So. So your time begins from when the gun goes off. So basically, if you're up the front, fantastic. You're gonna cross that timing chip within 10 or 15 seconds of the gun going off. But if you're at the back of the wave, back of the group, 25,000 runners, it could take 5 or 6 minutes before you start that cross line. So you're sort of a little bit behind the eight ball already, because the way Comrades works is there is cutoffs along the way, including the famous final cutoff at 12 hours. So 5:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m. All runners who do not finish by 5:30 p.m. they pretty much at 5:30 they form a human line across the finish line, and you basically haven't officially finished the race, and you won't pick up a medal. So pretty hard. Generally, I went to watch it, the 12-hour gun go off, just to get involved in the emotion and see these distraught runners who were so close but unfortunately didn't make it to the finish. So it's pretty heartbreaking, but that's some of the attraction of Comrades. Now, there's also cutoffs along the way. Can't remember the exact cutoffs. Again, they're all on the website. There's one, you know, maybe 50k in, and 60k in, and 70k in, whatever it might be. So if you're sort of just qualified to get into Comrades, and you're in those last waves, then clearly all those people are always trying to make that next the next cutoff. Keep an eye on their watch. What also happens over there with the sort of second half of the people running is runners form a group they call a bus, and some of them volunteer to become the bus driver, and basically just try to keep everyone moving on at a good pace so they can make those cutoffs, and also ultimately make that final cutoff at 5:30, that 12-hour cutoff. So that's another option to do it. It can sort of take your mind off what's actually going on, and there's a lot of singing and chanting, and there's a lot of it is the Comrades, so there's a lot of camaraderie and people helping each other out. So that's another way that you can actually sort of cope to actually get through the actual distance. There's the option that I took on, is to actually give a little bit of money to one of the South African teams, and that enables you to have drop bags, three drop bags along the way, three drop bag stations. So that was kilometer 38, kilometer 58, and kilometer 73. That enables you to put in any nutrition, any gear. I had a spare set of shoes in there at kilometer 58, just in case I was having issues with the shoes I was wearing and just wanted to change it out, blisters or maybe comfort or whatever it might be. So socks or, you know, anything like that. So that's a good option to use, and I'd certainly highly recommend it. Just have extra food in there. You may not know what you can stomach at the time, what you may feel like, but that way you can just put it all in. At least when you get there, you've actually got another option. Now, on the as far as stations go, there's a station, they seem to be coming up all the time, every 1.5, 2 Ks. Now, they actually provide water in these little plastic satchels that you just sort of bite into with your teeth, and you can and just get little bits, or you can, you know, bite a big gulp in it and take the whole thing. So you've got the water in the satchels. You also got like a Gatorade, I think they call it Energy or something like that. So it's like a Gatorade also, so a sports drink also in those satchels. And then you've got all the normal, you know, bits of fruit and lollies and all those sorts of things you can pick up along the way. Now, being an up here, obviously it has a history or it has a reputation of obviously the first 37-40k being uphill. You know, they say it'll be the hardest marathon you'll ever do just due to that elevation climb. It's certainly, what I want to share with you is I never really sort of got an indicator of actually how steep these climbs were. Now, they're generally sitting at an average of about, I would say, 5, maybe 7%. I used to be a cyclist, so I sort of get to know what a 5% climb is and a 10% climb is, or whatever it might be. So there's nothing, it's not as if you come around a corner and see a hill and go, oh my God, I can't believe how steep that is. You know, like 37 Ks with it. I think you climb about 1,000 or 1,200 metres in total in that marathon. I think it's 1,000 metres in the first 37 Ks. So it is 1,000 metres, a fair amount of climbing, but it is over 37 Ks. So some of the climbs, I think the longest climb, Boaters Hill, I think it's 3.2 kilometres long and an average of about 5 or 6%. So that's sort of what you're looking at. The other climbs are maybe 1.5, 2K climbs, averaging 5, 6, maybe there's some peaks in there about 7 or 8, but they're not very long. So they're just sort of long gradual climbs. I mean, if you've done city surf in Sydney and you know the Heartbreak Hill, it's sort of similar like that, but they're just a little bit longer. So it's not too bad, but yeah, you are climbing on the up here for the first 37-40K, and there's still climbs along the way. You've got the famous five hills. I think it starts with Cowies Hill, then you get into, which is about 16K in, then Fields Hill, which is about half marathon, or about 21K in, and then you get to Boaters Hill, I think they pronounce it, Boaters Hill, it's about 35K in, and then you get to, I think it's pronounced Chunga, about 45K in. So basically within the first 50, you got four of those big climbs out of the way. And then at about 76K in, you hit Little Pollies, and 80K in is Polly Shorts. So Polly Shorts is probably the steepest climb. It's about 1.2K long. I think it averages about 7 or 8%. So it's a decent climb, especially 80K in. The other thing that what a lot of people do is they do this walk-run strategy. Believe it or not, even the guys who pick up silver medals, sub 7.5, are still doing walk-run strategies. In the 50, 60, you know, 7 hours into a run and you come to a 5 or 6% climb, you know, generally sometimes you're better off just doing a walk-run strategy or just walking it. I'll just quickly touch on my race. My race went pretty sour after about 45K due to nutrition problems, stomach issues, couldn't keep anything down. I did something I should never do and did something new on race day when, due to the fact that I wasn't going to pick up any more liquid, any more of my bottles till 38K in, which is basically just over a 3 hour mark. I made up a concentrate. Now the concentrate was too high in carbohydrates and sodium, and after a few hours my body was repelling on it, and I really never bounced back from that. So yeah, just, you know, always think about what you're going to be taking in if you're going to have your own stuff. I mean, you can just drink what they provide you, but if you're going to do the three transition bags along the way, like I mentioned, and you've got your own nutrition, just make sure it's tried and tested in training. Don't make the mistake I did. So yeah, the second half for me was pretty average. And then towards the end of the race, it just came down to muscular fatigue and cramping, all those rest of things. There's people dropping like flies. There's medics out there. There's people out there trying to assist as best you can. But some people are getting the stage where they just cannot continue on for various reasons, and they end up in these buses. There's also medics out there with ambulances, and unfortunately seeing people getting put in an ambulance with only 5 or 6K to go is pretty heartbreaking. I certainly didn't want to be one of them, so I just kept moving as best as possible. For what it's worth, I finished in 8 hours 40, it was a tough day, and I'll be going back to try to remedy those issues I had out there. It's certainly worth going back for because it's an incredible race. Okay, so you got the distance, it's all on road, it's hard, the uphill is it is up. I think it's For the whole 87Ks, it was 1,800 metres of total climbing. And like I said, going from sea level to, and Pietermaritzburg sits at 600 metres above sea level. Now the highest part of the course is about, maybe it was about 60K in, that's about 820 metres above sea level. You sort of run along the ridge for about 20K. So basically 37, 40K, there's that climbing. Then you run along a ridge where you sort of, I mean, it's not flat, it's still ups and downs. I don't think there's hardly any flat on the course at all. So you're always going ups and downs. But there's a ridge when you're actually running along the highest part of the course for about 20K. So what I mean is there's no real big long climbs, so you can sort of still roll up and down them. But yeah, I mean, towards the end, when you're really fatigued, even the downhills are hurting. So that's what would make a downhill that I possibly may go back next year for so tough. You've already ran 50, 55K, the last 25, 30K is downhill and destroy your quads. And you know, really, really lighting up the knees. So that would be, people think a downhill would be easier. I don't know if it would be. Think of running downhill for 25, 30K, fatigue, shattered, banged up legs. I don't know, but anyway, I may find out anyway. So that's the go. Tough race. Seriously, you got to have a fair amount of K's in your legs before you actually go over there. And yeah, depending on how fast you go, depends on what sort of medal you get. So the top 10 get the gold medal, and then that's generally the winner this year was in 531. The female from South Africa was the first female ever to run in 6 hours, and she won by 10 minutes. So she went 5:58, so that's an incredible time. But yeah, generally the winners around about the 5:30 to the 5:40 mark, and the top 10 guys who are under 6 hours will get the gold medal. And then there's a medal from the 6 to 7.5, and then there's the 6 to 7, I think it is. And then the silver medal sub 7.5, so and then from 7:30 to 9 hours is the Billy Rowan medal, and then they introduced a new medal this year from 9 to 10, and then from 10 to 11:30 or 11 hours you get the bronze, and then there's another medal that you get if you just sub 12. But again, it's all on the website, but there are a lot of people out there trying to get a particular medal, so they're actually trying to run at a particular pace to either be sub 9 or sub 10:30 or sub 11, or like I said, just get the bronze medal and either sub 12 or whatever it might be. So there's also a lot of other incentives out there besides just finishing. It's, you know, people who may have never picked up a silver medal might be trying to go sub 7:30. People who never picked up a Bill Ryan medal might be going to sub 9. So there's all those other little incentives out there. But at the end of the day, it's a long, hard day. You're out there for a long time, so it's basically pacing yourself as slow as you possibly can. That's still comfortable. To get the 7:30, the silver medal, that's an average of 5:11. So it's not a real fast race. It's banal. Just yeah, it's a race of attrition and nutrition. It's a race of just being able to keep ticking over. And like I said, sub 9, you definitely can still be doing a lot of walking. You pretty much walk most of those climbs and still be able to go sub 9. So it's just being able to pace yourself out there, hydrate well, get your nutrition right, and hopefully you'll get to the finish. But the atmosphere is absolutely amazing. I went on safari before I went to the race and got up there, and that was incredible. Cape Town, I'll do next time when I'm over there. It looks absolutely beautiful, the Tabletop Mountains, and there's an incredible national park, and the views from top of those mountains down over Cape Town looks incredible. So yeah, hopefully you got something out of that. It's certainly put it on your list if you're able to actually get over there, and you certainly will not be disappointed. Just make sure you get those K's in your legs so that you're actually ready for it. All right, bye for now. Thanks.